the 2022 Cadillac CT4 V Blackwing. Now, this doesn't actually have a Blackwing engine. It does kind of have a blackish wing on the back. But if it weren't for that carbon fiber package, then the only way to tell that it's a Blackwing is obviously to look inside and check the tag on the seats. You know, the same way that you check what size your shirt is. So if you didn't have that carbon fiber package, you can kind of almost fly under the radar in this one. Maybe people would just think you have a CT4V. That is, of course, until you turn it over. Then you're pretty squarely on everyone's radar. Man, is this thing wonderful to shift. When your friends with V8s make fun of you for not having a V8, well, this 3.6 liter LF4 is really no slouch. It's a twin turbo six cylinder and it produces 472 horsepower and 445 pound feet of torque, so that's more power than a Mustang GT or a Camaro. Really is a four-door muscle car with a luxury badge. Having those extra two doors is huge, especially if you're a car enthusiast who's also a parent like I am. I've got a two-year-old and a four-year-old and I've been doing the daycare runs, and those two extra doors are huge. My four-year-old can easily climb up into her seat on her own. My two-year-old, I can get him in pretty easily as well. Now, if you have a rear-facing seat, it's gonna be a lot tighter. You know, these front seats are both set for me at 5'7", so if you're any taller than me, you might have trouble with a rear-facing seat. Now, if you're an adult and you do fit back there, you're gonna have a nice, comfortable ride. This one has the upgraded premium leather seats and they are very comfortable, especially up here in the front in the driver's seat. I would highly recommend getting the upgraded seats because you do have the thigh extensions and the power adjustable bolsters. This thing is hugging me like it's excited that I'm in here because it knows it's about to get driven. Super comfortable. The heated seats are standard, but the ventilated seats are part of the climate package. And this suede steering wheel, super nice. Nice little carbon fiber touchdown here with the V logo. Now, one of the big points of contention with some of the earlier Cadillacs, like the ATS-V, was that the Q system was awful. Now, this one, it is super smooth, nice and easy to use, nice big icons. And we actually have wireless Android Auto, wireless Apple CarPlay, and we have wireless charging. But the one issue I did have was with the nav system. It requires voice control while you're driving, and it couldn't understand what I was trying to tell it. And actually, one of the places that's been there for years, it didn't come up on the points of interest. So I was really struggling with that. But the nav itself works really well, and it even integrates with the heads-up display. Now, a heads-up display is part of the technology package. That is not standard. I would definitely get that technology package with the heads-up display plus the air ionizer. We'll get into what exactly is on there as we go here. Now, unfortunately, my phone is too old to use wireless Android Auto, so I did use wired, and that's fine. It works perfectly normal. If you've used Android Auto before, then you'll have no issues with it. And it actually does have Amazon Alexa as well as Spotify built in. So if you usually listen to Spotify anyway, then you don't even have to hook in. Up here we have the nice big gauge cluster. I'm super happy with the way they did this. It's really sleek. It's really smooth as well with the transitions, and it transitions a lot because when you change your modes, it actually changes the whole layout. You can tell it not to do that if you want. If you like one particular layout better, you just pick that as your standard. But there's a ton of information in here. Now, it's got all your standard stuff, your fuel economy, your tach, your speedometer, all that. It has the speed limit in here as well. But it's also got your tire pressure, and you can set some different blocks over here. The lateral G-force, you can put your boost in there. It'll show you your 0 to 60 time. And that heads-up display I mentioned before, that also changes with the different modes. It shows your speed, it shows what gear you're in, and when you're using the nav again, it shows you your directions if you're getting close to a turn. My favorite part about it is that it shows your tach. So it has this weird vertical tach going on here in some of your driving modes, and it shows that up there, which is a really cool feature. I love seeing that. Now, that's all the digital and touch stuff, but down here we have a bunch of regular buttons, and they work out really well. These are all buttons and switches for climate control, heated seats, ventilated seats, lane assist, your parking sensors. This does have parking sensors, which is good because it's got that front splitter sticking off the front. It's kind of hard to tell where you are sometimes. And across the steering wheel, your heated steering wheel button is on the steering wheel, nice and easy to use. And your standard stuff here with your infotainment control, your informational control here, cruise control. Now the adaptive cruise control, unfortunately, is only available if you get the auto, and we are here in the manual, which is not unfortunate. And the two best buttons on the steering wheel, actually one's a button and one is a switch. We've got the V mode, that's your custom mode. Get straight into that rather than having to cycle through all the different modes. You just go straight into your custom mode, which is your fully customizable suspension, engine noise, LSD, because this has a limited slip differential in the rear. It's electronic, so you can control that, as well as your steering feel. And this other switch over here is your traction control, so you can easily just switch that. Inactive, active, wet, dry, that's your traction. Super nice. Love having that right there. Then over on the side, you got your parking brake. It is a button, not my favorite, but at least it's not a switch. When it's a switch, I never remember which is push and which is pull. It's just a button, so you just push. You can update your heads-up display over there, what info it's showing. You can move it around a little bit. And we've got a spot for an SD card over there too. Over here, we can kind of tell you got some cheap plastics down in the lower part of the door. Can't really fit much in there either. Like in my GTI, I can get an Nalgene, which I know is not standard, but it would be nice to be able to fit something. I can't fit my to-go mug in there either. And there's no carpet or anything in there. It's just hard plastic. But the touch points up top, all pretty good. The steering wheel itself, obviously really nice. And up here across the dash, we got the 8KG system in this one. It's fine. Nothing to write home about. It sounds a little flat to me. I know it's adjustable, but I tried listening to a bunch of different genres, and it kind of just didn't sound awesome. And of course, we've got the 6-speed manual transmission, which we will talk about more as we go here. The 3D printed coin on top, very cool. Carbon fiber all around it. A big issue with a lot of manual transmission cars, of course, is where they put the cup holder. And it's not super in the way, but it's not exactly out of the way. You know, I bump it a little bit with my arm, but it's not a deal breaker. Just be careful if you've got a bigger cup over there. Oh, and we've got a little Easter egg here. Since this is the manual, we don't have paddle shifters, but we do have the Milford Proving Grounds over here on the side, as well as the tech center. That's pretty cool, little maps showing up over there. Okay, that's enough about talking about the interior. Let's take it for a drive. Let's talk about the important things like the 0-60. Which we pretty easily hit in second gear. We got that out of the way. Well, we're gonna do it again a few more times, don't worry. A 0-60 time of 4.1 seconds in the manual, easily getting there in second gear. That drops down to 3.9 if you're in the automatic, but I would get the manual. And I'm so glad I'm in the manual. If you've driven any other cars on the Alpha platform, this is nothing new to you, but this car handles way better than it should. It weighs 3,800 pounds and it has a luxury badge, and it can take a corner like it's nothing. And of course, it has the kick to come out of that corner hard. And of course, this one has the 6-speed manual. This is a Tremec 6-speed, the TRC. This is the TR6060, and it has a nice short shift linkage. It is a joy to shift. Nice, solid track, so precise, no slop, feels so good, as does the clutch. The clutch is on the heavier side, which is perfect for a more performance-oriented car, but it's not so heavy that you couldn't daily drive it. It has great feel to it. Now, with all that sporty suspension setup and all of that, you kind of expect, okay, it's a performance car, it's not going to ride very well. But it's also a Cadillac, and the ride quality is shockingly good. Honestly, even in the stiffest settings, I could live with that every day. And there are some pretty rough roads here around me in Connecticut. And I've been doing the daily duty here with a mix of city, a mix of highway, and no issues with ride quality on any of the rough roads. Smooth roads obviously are fine. It does get a little bit loud in here, but I think that's mostly just tire noise. I'm on winter tires, unfortunately, just because it is cold out. I think on summer tires, it might not be quite as loud. And there's no hill hold on this, which I actually like. Now again, because of that luxury badge, we do also get a lot of standard features. We have blind spot monitoring, we have integrated turn signals, we have heated mirrors, we have adaptive cruise, though you have to get the auto for that, womp womp, as well as remote start, which I wouldn't want to have in a manual anyway, because I feel like I would definitely forget to leave my car in neutral. And as I mentioned before, the parking assist, the lane keep assist, and the speed limit display. LEDs in the back here, LEDs up front too. Super easy to see at night, nice and bright. And we've even got some cornering lights. Now, if you do plan to track this and you need that extra downforce, definitely go for the carbon fiber packs. Note, you have to unlock the second carbon fiber pack by buying the first carbon fiber packs. But if you're not planning to track it, this thing is still tons of fun on the road, even without the carbon fiber, I'm sure. And it's still got a huge amount of cooling across the front. We've got all these vents all over the place and stuff. These are in 18s, by the way, and 18s are your only option. These are satin black, and we've got the big Brembo brakes here. These are the gold ones, which was an extra $600 or something to paint them gold. This thing is just so confident around the corners. It's so fun. It does not make any sense that something with a luxury badge, Cadillac badge, such a smooth ride, can handle so well. Now again, whether you plan to track it or not, you can actually go to Spring Mountain and get a free 2-day course just for buying one of these, so definitely check that out. Now if you plan to buy one of these, which you absolutely should, because it is one of the best manuals in modern manuals right now. Such a great engine. It's the best sounding six-cylinder of any six-cylinder I've been in, for sure. And it makes gobs of power for a six-cylinder. I've been daily driving this, and it's been awesome. Daycare run, city, highway, everything. So comfortable, handles so nicely on the twisty back roads. I've been taking a long way to work. But you might run into some bumps along the way. I talked to some buyers and they told me about their buying woes, and it didn't sound like such a great process. It sounds like the dealer allocation system could use some work. One of the people told me that the allocations are actually based on previous sales history at the dealership. So if you can find a dealership, first of all, that's not charging a market adjustment, then you have to see if they have an allocation, or you have to add yourself to the wait list. And once that comes around, you get your allocation, then there's still a ton of waiting. And especially if you want to get the carbon fiber bits that I mentioned before, which is, here's another reason not to get them, it's the same deal that we had with the C8 Corvette. The shortage, they're having issues with the carbon fiber supply, so you're going to be waiting even longer. And then even after that, once the car is built, you may still be waiting. One of the guys said his car was built on November 30th, and he's finally just getting it this week. This is now March, today's March 6th, and it's this week that he's finally getting his. And he really didn't have any explanation as to why. So that might leave a little bit of a bad taste in your mouth, but believe me, once you drive it, that taste will go away. Now the big question is CT4V Blackwing or CT5V Blackwing or CT4V Blackwing or M3. And that's kind of where you guys come in, because I can't tell you because I haven't driven either of those other two. And subscriptions and views are kind of my currency to get into newer cars and bring them to you. So if you can, so that's where you guys can help me by subscribing, sharing to one friend or one group that you think is going to like this video and help, be able to help me out. And thanks for tuning in. I'll see you next time.